Good morning, children. Welcome to another class of Biobotany. In today's Biobotany class, we are going to start with a new lesson, Unit 16, Plant and Animal Hormones. In that, I will be teaching you plant hormones. By the end of this lesson, after finishing learning this lesson, you will be able to define the hormone. You will know what are the different types of plant hormones. You will be able to classify the plant hormones into growth, promoters and growth inhibitors. Promoters, which helps in the growth of the plant. Inhibitors means which suppress or reduces the growth in the plant. Next, you will be able to differentiate the physiological, you will be knowing the physiological effects of various plant hormones. And next, you will be understanding how plant hormones, they control and coordinates various physiological activities in plant. Okay, children. Let's start with the introduction of this plant hormones. Okay, so here the word hormone is derived from a Greek word which means to excite. Okay, so hormone word is derived from a Greek word meaning it to excite. The function of control and coordination in plants are performed by chemical substance produced by the plants. They are called as plant hormones. So what are these plant hormones? They are the chemical substance. And these chemical substances, they are produced by the plants. Okay. So plant hormones, they are the chemical substance produced by the plant. Control and coordinate the plant growth. Okay. Plant hormones, they are the chemical substance produced by the plants which control and coordinate the plant growth. These plant hormones, they are produced in several cells of the plant. Okay. In plants, several cells, they have an ability to synthesize this plant hormones. Phyto means plant. These phytohormones, they are transported to different parts of the plant to perform various physiological functions. So here, as we have studied, most of the cells in the plant, they can synthesize one or the other type of plant hormones. And these hormones, from one place, they are transported to the another place to perform its function. So let's study in detail about the plant hormones. Now, the definition of plant hormones. Plant hormones, they are organic molecules. Okay, plant hormones, they are organic molecules. They are produced at extremely low concentration. Or little amount of plant hormones, they are secreted in the cells. Okay, but the role played by this plant hormone is a big role they are performing. These molecules, they control the morphological. Morphological means the external appearance, maybe the height, the growth. Okay, so that is controlled. Next, physiological. Physiological means how the growth of the root is taking place, the shoot is taking place, the apical growth. Okay, so these are all the physiological and biochemical responses. So biochemical responses like the breakdown of the glucose, you can take it as a biochemical process. So here these auxins, they are produced, these plant hormones, they are produced at a very low concentration, but the role played by these plant hormones is a big role. Okay, they control the morphological function, physiological function as well as the biochemical responses. Next, we'll be studying about the types of plant hormones. So here, there are five major classes of plant hormones. So the plant hormones, there are five major classes are there. They are auxins, cytokinins, gibberellins, abscisic acid and ethylene. Okay, so as we have studied, there are five classes of plant hormones. They are auxins, cytokinins, gibberellins and abscisic acid. Among all these plant hormones, auxins, gibberellins and cytokinins, they promote plant growth. Okay, they induces, they support, they help the growth of the plant. So they are called as growth promoters. Okay, so what are the growth promoters? Auxins, cytokinins and gibberellins. Whereas abscisic acid and ethylene, they are plant growth inhibitors. Okay. So this abscisic acid and ethylene, what they will do? They will inhibit the growth. They will stop the growth of the plant. So they are called as growth inhibitors. So we have studied there are 5 types of plant hormones. Okay, they are auxins, cytokinins, gibberellins, abscisic acid and ethylene. They are classified into plant growth promoters as well as growth inhibitors. Growth promoter plant hormones are auxins, cytokinins and gibberellins. Growth inhibitors are abscisic acid and ethylene. So here in the diagram you can see in the different plant parts the different types of plant hormones are synthesized. So here on the tip you can find the auxins are produced. They will control the elongation of the stem. Next you can see in the down you can see the ripening of the fruit. After the fruit formation is taking place, the ripening of the fruit is controlled by the ethylene. Next, the growth of the young fruits, development of the young fruits, cytokinin is helping there. Next here, abscission zone. Okay, formation of the abscission zone is helped by the ethylene. And prevention of this abscission layer formation is done by the auxins. Next, closure of the stomata. The closing of the stomata is controlled by the abscisic acid. Next, you can see here in the side, the cell division is controlled by cytokinins. So different plant hormones in the different plant parts, they play their role there. So let's study one by one all the plant hormones. So first plant hormone we are going to study is auxins. Auxins, the word auxin is a Greek word, means to grow. This was the first plant hormone discovered. So the first plant hormone discovered is auxin. This auxin was discovered, was isolated from the human urine. Okay, so this term auxin was introduced by Kogel and Hagen-Smith. Okay, auxins, they are produced at the tip of the stem and the roots. So you have to remember where these auxins are synthesized in the plant. They are produced at the tip of the root and tip of the shoot. Okay. From where they migrate to the zone of elongation. Already we have studied in the structure of the root. In the previous lesson we have studied. In that we studied we have the meristematic zone. The meristematic zone protected by the root cap. Behind the meristematic zone we have the zone of elongation. And behind the zone of elongation we have the zone of maturation. So here we have studied that in the roots the auxin is synthesized at the tip. Okay. And from this tip, this auxins, they are migrated or they are transported to the zone of elongation. Okay. Next, we are going to understand here. The Charles Darwin in 1880 observed unilateral. Unilateral means only in one direction the growth is taking place. So, Charles Darwin observed unilateral growth and curvature of canary grass coleoptiles. Curvature means bending down of the coleoptile is what the grass is a monocot plant. In the grass, the young shoot is surrounded by a layer that is called as the coleoptile. So here Charles Darwin in 1880 made an observation that the unilateral growth as well as the curvature of canary grass. Okay, so he came to the conclusion that some influence was transmitted from the tip of the coleoptile to the basal region. So he observed that this because the reason for this unilateral growth or the curvature in the coleoptile was due to some substance which is transmitted downwards. This influence was later identified by auxin, identified as auxin by Wendt. So this was later on, it was called as auxin by a scientist called Wendt. Okay, so he performed an experiment that is called as a Wendt's experiment. So let's study that Wendt's experiment in detail. So Fritz Warmelt Wendt, it's the time period 1903 to 1990, is a Dutch biologist. Wendt is a Dutch biologist. An effect of auxins in the plants. Okay, so he showed that is some chemical substance in the tip of the plant, and what is the role, what is the effect of this auxin was explained with the help of by the Wendt in his Wendt's experiment. He did a series of experiment on Avena coleoptile plant. In the Avena plant he performed his experiment. So let's study this experiment. In his first experiment, he removed the tip of the Avena coleoptile. Now here you can see in the diagram ABC. Diagram A represents the germination of a oat seed. Oat seed is a monocot seed. That is germination of the oat seed is shown here. So here you can see a leaf-like structure. A coleoptile is growing there. Next here in the B diagram, decapitated. Decapitated means the tip of the coleoptile is removed there. So here in his first experiment, what he did, he removed the tip of the coleoptile. Okay, tip of the coleoptile was removed and he made an observation in the plant. He observed that the cut tips did not grow any indicating that the tips produce something essential for growth. So here he made an observation, when the tip was cut down, the plant did not show any growth. Okay, when the tip was cut down, the plant did not show any growth. So he made a conclusion that some substance is produced in the tip which is promoting the growth in the plant. In his second experiment, what he did, he placed the agar block on the decapitated coleoptile tip. Now, agar block is obtained from the algae. Agar is obtained from the algae and it is used in the laboratories for culture purpose. Culturing of the bacteria, fungus, we are using this agar. So, what he did, after cutting the coleoptile tip, he kept an agar block. Then he made an observation. He observed that here also the coleoptile tip did not show any response. Okay, it did not show any growth here. In his next experiment, in the third experiment, what he did, he placed the detached coleoptile tips on the agar blocks. In the third experiment, what he did, he cut the tip of the coleoptile and the cut end was kept over the agar block for 1 hour. Okay, he placed the detached coleoptile tip on the agar block. After an hour, he discarded the tip. Okay, after 1 hour, he removed the tip from the agar block and he placed that agar block on the decapitated coleoptile tip. So, in the third experiment, what he did, he cut the tip of the plant and kept that cut end over an agar block for 1 hour. After 1 hour, he removed the tip, that is coleoptile tip, from the agar block and he kept only the agar block over the coleoptile over the stem. Okay, it grew straight up. Okay, so here he made an observation, the plant started growing straight. Okay, indicating that some chemical had diffused from the cut coleoptile tips into the agar block, which has stimulated the growth. So he made a conclusion that the cut end of the coleoptile tip has diffused some substance into the agar block. That substance has helped in the growth of the plant. So the first experiment, what he did, he cut the tip of the coleoptile plant and made the observation, no growth took place. Second experiment, what he did, he cut the tip of the coleoptile plant and he kept an agar block over the plant. So here also he observed that no growth is taking place. In the third experiment, what he did, he cut the tip of the coleoptile plant and kept that tip over the agar block for 1 hour. After one hour, that tip of the coleoptile was discarded and only this agar block was kept over the plant. And to his observation, he found that the plant started growing straight. So he concluded from this experiment that a chemical diffusing from the tip of the coleoptile was responsible for the growth. So he concluded that something has diffused from the tip of the coleoptile into the agar block that made the plant to grow, and that he called it as auxin, and auxin means to grow here. Next, we will be studying about the types of auxins. So auxins, they are classified into two types, namely natural auxins and synthetic auxins. So auxins, they are classified into two, natural auxins and synthetic auxins. Now, what are these natural auxins? Natural auxins are produced by the plants. Okay, natural auxins, they are produced by the plants and they are called as natural auxins. Example for natural auxin is IAA, indole 3 acetic acid. Next type of auxin is synthetic auxin. synthetic auxins. They are the artificially synthesized. It is not produced, synthetic auxin is not produced by the plant. It is made, man-made, artificially synthesized, and that have the properties like the auxin. So example for synthetic auxin is 2,4-D, 2,4-dichlorophenoxyacetic acid. So there are types of auxins. There are two types of auxins. They are natural auxins and synthetic auxins. Next, we are going to study about the physiological effects of auxins. Now, these auxins, they bring about a variety of physiological effects in different parts of the plant body. So, what are the effects we are going to study here? First, auxins promote the elongation of stem and coleoptiles, which make them to grow. As we know, these auxins, they are synthesized only in the tip of the plant, in the root tip as well as in the shooting. So this auxin in the shoot tip, it will cause the elongation of the stem as well as in the coleoptile, which makes them to grow. Clear? Next is, this auxin, they induce root formation at low concentration. As we have studied, the auxin is synthesized in the shoot tip as well as in the root tip. More concentration of auxin in the shoot tip will make the stem to grow. Okay, but in the root tip, if the concentration of auxin is less only, the root will grow. More the concentration of auxin in the root tip, it will inhibit or it will stop the growth of the root. Okay, so the auxins can promote the growth of the root only in low concentration. So that is what the second point. Auxin induce root formation at low concentration and inhibit at higher concentration. Next, the third point, the auxins produced by the apical buds suppresses the growth of the lateral bud. This is called as apical dominance. So as we know, in the growth of the plant, there are growth points are present there. The growth in the plant, it takes place at the tip of the stem. So in the tip of the stem, what is present there? Apical bud is present there. And in the stem tip only, the auxins are present, secreted. So here, this apical bud, it will show the growth and it will suppress the growth, or it will stop the growth of the lateral bud. If the apical bud is there, the growth of the lateral bud means the side bud, which leads to the development of the branches, that bud will be stopped there. Okay, so here you have studied that if the apical bud is present there, okay, the auxin which is produced in the apical bud will suppress the growth of the lateral bud. And this is called as an apical dominance. So again, it's a 2-mark question. What is apical dominance? So the auxins produced by the apical bud suppresses the growth of lateral bud. This is called as apical dominance. Next, we are going to study about the fourth point. Seedless fruits without fertilization are induced by external application of auxins. Now, as we know, in a plant, the fruit is produced only after fertilization. That is, after the fusion of the male gamete and female gamete only, the fruit formation takes place. Okay. But here, by the external application, by the application of this auxin over the flower, the seedless fruits or the fruits can be produced without the act of fertilization, without the involvement of fertilization also, the fruits can be synthesized by the external application of this auxin. Okay. So here, since the fruit is produced without the act of fertilization, these fruits, they do not contain any seeds there. So seedless fruits are produced. So seedless fruits without the fertilization, they are induced by the external application of auxins, and they are called as parthenocarpy. This phenomena is called as parthenocarpy, and the fruits, they are called as parthenocarpic fruits. So what is parthenocarpic fruits? The fruits which are developed without the act of fertilization. Okay, so here, by the external application of auxins, seedless fruits can be synthesized. Example for parthenocarpic fruits are watermelon, grape, lime, etc. So in these fruits, by the external application, in these plants, by the external application of auxin, seedless fruits can be produced. Fifth point is, auxin prevents the formation of abscission layer. Abscission layer is a layer which is found in the to detach the old part of the plant. So in the old part of the plant, the vascular tissues are blocked there by a layer of tissues that is called as abscission layer. So here auxin prevents the formation of this abscission layer. Okay, so when the abscission layer is formed only, what will happen? You can see from the plants, the leaf falls down, the flowers fall down, the fruits fall down. So this is because of the formation of the abscission layer. So here, this shedding down of the leaves, flowers and fruits, that is prevented by the auxins. So here we have studied five physiological effects of auxins. First one we have studied, that is auxins, they promote elongation of the stem. Second we have studied, auxin induce root formation at low concentration. Third we have studied, auxin produced in the apical bud will inhibit the growth of the lateral bud, and this is called as apical dominance. Next we have studied, seedless fruits without the fertilization can be produced by the external application of auxin, and they are called as parthenocarpy fruits. And the fifth point we have studied, auxins, they prevent the formation of the abscission layer. As we have already studied the types of auxins, there are two types of auxins, natural auxins and synthetic auxins. Few more examples of natural and synthetic auxins are given here. So example, phenyl acetic acid PAA and indole 3 acetonitrile IAN are natural auxins. Indole 3 butyric acid and indole 3 propionic acid, alpha naphthalene acetic acid and 2,4-5-trichlorophenoxyacetic acid are some of the synthetic auxins. So this is what we have studied about the auxins we have studied. So your auxins, they are produced in the root tip, shoot tip. Function is elongation of the stem. Okay, stem and the roots. Next we have studied their types we have studied. Next we have studied the physiological effects of auxin. Next we are going to study the another plant hormone, that is cytokinin. The word cyto means cell. Kinesis means division. So these are the plant hormones. Cytokinin is a plant hormone which promotes cell division or cytokinesis. Okay, cytokinins, they are the plant hormones which promote cell division or cytokinesis in the plant cells. This was first isolated in herringfish sperm. Okay, zeaxanthin is a type of cytokinin. This is isolated from the sea maize. Cytokinin is found abundantly in liquid endosperm. You have seen in the coconut, the fluid, the liquid is present inside the coconut. That liquid is called as the endosperm. In that liquid endosperm, the concentration of cytokinin is more. Okay, abundant cytokinin is found in the liquid endosperm. Next, we are going to study about the physiological effects of cytokinin. So here, first function of cytokinin, as we have already studied, cytokinin, they will induce cell division. They promote cell division along with the auxins. So cytokinin and auxins together, they play a role in this cell division. Next, cytokinin causes the cell enlargement, as I told you. Both cytokinin and auxins together, they play the role. Cytokinin causes the cell division and auxins, they will causes the cell enlargement. Next, both auxins and cytokinins are essential for the formation of new organs from the callus in tissue culture. Now, tissue culture is a method or a technique of developing an entire plant from culturing an entire plant from a single cell. Because in the plants, as plant cell has this ability, that is called as a totipotency, that is from a single cell an entire plant can be developed. Okay, so for this in the tissue culture, from that single cell the entire plant has to be developed. For this, in the culture medium, a plant hormones, so auxins and the cytokinins are taken. So what will happen, only one single cell we have taken, but in the culture medium what is present there, auxin and cytokinin is present there. So in this auxins and cytokinin, they will help in the cell division and cell enlargement. As a result, from one single cell we get a mass of cell. That mass of cell is called as a callus. Now from this mass of cells, some separate cells can develop into root, some can develop into shoot. So this callus is also said to be an undifferentiated mass. Okay, so from a single cell, in tissue culture, from a single cell, a mass of undifferentiated cells is developed, that is called as callus. So for this callus formation also, this auxins and cytokinins, they are essential. Next point is what? Cytokinin, they promote the growth of the lateral bud even in the presence of the apical bud. So here, by the application of the cytokinin on the lateral bud can also be made to grow. As we have already studied in the functions effects of the auxins, that is auxin, what they do, they inhibit the growth of the lateral bud in the presence of the apical bud. So here what is done? If by the application, let the apical bud be there, by application of the cytokinin over the lateral bud, the lateral bud can also be made to grow there. Fifth point is, by the application of auxin, the aging process can be delayed. So application of cytokinin delays the process of aging in plants, and this effect is called as Richmond-Lange effect. Okay, so this again another 2-mark question, Richmond-Lange effect. What is it? By the application of cytokinin delays the process of aging in plants. This is called as Richmond-Lange effect. Okay children, so today we have studied about two plant hormones, auxins and cytokinins. So hope you have understood both the plant hormones. In the next class we will study the remaining plant hormones. Thank you children.